Well, Happy New Year and welcome to a fresh start. And boy, do we ever need one, right? Clarity and alignment are absolutely essential for a church. And that's why when things happen like last year and COVID, we find ourselves really needing to fix our focus again on things that are good. Regardless of how good our intentions are, without the right kind of clarity and focus, the result's going to be failure. I think the message of Micah is going to give us a great insight during the month of January on how God can help us get a fresh focus again on what really matters most. It's a very familiar passage in Micah chapter 6 and verse 8. The Lord has shown you what is good. What does the Lord require of you? You must act with justice. You must love to show mercy. And you must walk humbly with your God. Let me give you a little backstory for the prophet Micah. He was God's spokesman in the later part of the 8th century B.C. God had promised Abraham to make his descendants into a great nation. His son Isaac and his son Jacob were part of that. And then his grandson Jacob had 12 sons. And their descendants became known as the nation of Israel. And that's who God sent Moses to rescue and set free from slavery in Egypt. God gave them his Ten Commandments at Mount Sinai, and they're the ones that Joshua would eventually lead into the Promised Land to become the independent nation of Israel, just like he had promised Abraham centuries before. Eventually, the 12 tribal states of God's people split up. The northern 10 became known as Israel. The southern two tribes became known as Judah. An enemy nation called Assyria was determined to destroy both Israel and Judah and claim their land for themselves. Micah had already seen the 10 northern tribal states, also known as Israel, lose their nation to Assyria. He'd witnessed Assyria relocate those 10 northern tribes of God's people into captivity, and he saw the same thing about to happen to those remaining two tribal states known as Judah. Micah was God's messenger to help his people understand what went wrong and how to fix their focus. And honestly, as we look around in our country and nation at this particular time, we're hearing stories here in the United States of not being united any longer, but maybe some states seceding from our union and splitting up just like the nation of God's people did back then. Maybe when we refocus on what God says is important, we as God's people can begin the process of doing the right things to keep that from happening. You see, God wanted his people to know that the problem was not the military strength of their enemy, Assyria. Their real problem was their own moral weakness, not their military strength, but our own moral weakness that had led them away from God's will. They'd become their own worst enemy because they lost their focus on actually living like the people of God. Here's a quick summary of what God wanted them to focus on from Micah 6, verses 9 through 12. Fear the Lord if you are wise. His voice calls to everyone in Jerusalem. The armies of destruction are coming. The Lord is sending them. The Lord is sending them. Why would God do that? Why would God send an enemy army to destroy his own people? He'll go on. Verse 10 of Micah 6. What shall I say about the homes of the wicked that are filled with treasures gained by cheating? What about the disgusting practice of measuring out grain with dishonest measures? How can I tolerate your merchants who use dishonest scales and weights? The rich among you have become wealthy through the extortion and violence. Your citizens are so used to lying that their tongues can no longer tell the truth. I swear he could be talking to Washington, D.C. or any other political party headquarters, couldn't he? Extortion, lying, doing whatever it takes just to pad your own pockets, it sounds exactly like the condition that our country is in right now. And so you begin to see why Micah's message from God on how to fix their focus is so relevant for right now. You see, the odd thing is, it wasn't because they'd lost focus on the priority of worship. They're still observing all of their religious ceremonies and celebrations, and they're still bringing their offerings to God. The ironic thing is, God wasn't focused on how frequently they attended a worship service or how much of their tithe and offering they brought. Instead, God was focused on how they were actually treating each other in everyday life. His people were crying out against God, "That's not fair. God, why are you treating this way? We're still going to worship. We're still offering you our tithes and offerings." And God sends Micah with his response to their complaint about how he was treating them. In verse 1 and 2 of Micah 6, it says, "The Lord said to his people, 'Come, present your case to the hills and the mountains. Israel, I'm bringing my charges against you. I call upon the mountains and the earth's firm foundation to be my witness.'" God calls the mountains to the witness stand in this trial between his people and him, because the mountains have been there the whole time. The mountains have seen it all. In verse 3 through 5 of Micah 6, the Lord says, "My people, what have I done to you? Have I made things too hard for you? Answer me. I brought your people up out of Egypt and set you free from slavery. I sent Moses and Aaron and Miriam to lead you. Remember how Balak, the king of Moab, planned to put a curse on your people? But Balaam, my prophet, gave them a blessing instead. Remember their journey from Shittim to Gilgal? I want you to know that I always do what is right." That kind of brings us to the first point. When you need to check your focus, let's start with a big letter up on top of the chart. And the big letters on top of the chart, as far as God's concerned, say this: God has been good. Do you remember when you were trapped as slaves? Who set you free? That was me. Do you remember when you didn't know which way to go as you had your new freedom? Who sent you people to guide you? God says that was me. Remember when bad people wanted to do bad things to you? Who changed it into a blessing? Again, God says, "I know the answer to that. It's me." Remember when you were ready to leave Shittim behind and yet the Jordan River was at flood stage? Who stopped the flood waters so you could cross over to Gilgal on dry ground? Again, that was me. "I've always done right by you," God says. So when you lose focus on how God has always done right by you and how God has treated you, how you ought to treat others begins to get a little fuzzy. What did your kids do when they got caught and you told them what their punishment was going to be? God's people do the same thing. They begin to negotiate for a plea bargain. What can we do to make this go away? What can we do to make the punishment a little more tolerable? In Micah 6, verse 6 and 7, he says, "What offering shall I bring when I bow down to worship before the Lord God Most High? You say, should I try to please him by sacrificing calves a year old? Will thousands of sheep or rivers of olive oil make God satisfied with me? Should I sacrifice to the Lord my firstborn child as payment for my terrible sin?" It's almost as though you can hear them saying, "What can we do, God, so you'll drop the charges? You know, let's be reasonable here. I know that everybody's got a price. What's your price, God? How much of a bribe will it take to make this all just go away?" Did you notice that everything they wanted to offer God revolved around their temple ceremonies? It's the same thing today when things fall apart in people's lives. What's the very first thing they say, especially if they've got a church background? "I need to get back to church." Why do they say that? Same reason why the people in Micah's day said that. We begin to plea bargain to refocus on better worship practices. And yet in verse 8 of Micah 6, he says, "The Lord has shown you what is good. What does the Lord require of you? You must act with justice. You must love to show mercy. And you must walk humbly with your God." When you need to check your focus, like I said, let's start with the big letters at the top of the chart. God really has simplified and clarified what that focus needs to be. And He's defined good this way: justice, mercy, humility. Repeat. Justice, mercy, humility. Repeat. You see, let me give you an illustration of this kind of simplicity and how much of a difference it can make when we're clear in our focus. There was a publisher that you may or may not have ever heard of named William Spalding. And this publisher bet one of his writers, a guy named Theodore Geisel, $50. Now, this was back when $50 was a big deal because it was in the late 40s. And here was his challenge. Write me a story that first graders can't put down. But here's your standard. You can only use 225 words. Well, the result of that was a book that you may have heard of. It was called The Cat in the Hat by Dr. Seuss. Theodore Geisel used his mother's maiden name and bequeathed upon himself the title of doctor. And it was so successful that he and a partner actually opened their own publishing house. You may have heard of it, Random House. A few years later, that same partner made a similar challenge, only this time he decided to get even more strict in his requirements to win the bet. I want you to use 50 words. And the result? Green Eggs and Ham sold over 200 million copies. You see, the challenge actually increased his creativity. He said, "When I understood what I had to concentrate and focus on, it actually improved my writing." God's message to His people through Micah was very clear and very focused. I want you to focus on the things that matter most. If you want to fix your focus, then ask God, ask yourself, am I willing to let God tell me what He thinks is good? Or am I just going to continue doing what I think God will be happy with and hope that He plea bargains my punishment down to something more manageable? When you want to check your focus and check with the big letters at the top of the chart, one of the things you'll see is that being good isn't just being in the right place. Now, I'm not saying it isn't good to go to the right place like church, or that being in worship is a bad thing. But there is a way of going to a place that ends up with people actually having their priorities out of place. You've known people like that, right? They're in the right place on Sunday, but they think as long as they go to the right place and do the right thing, that they can go anywhere and do anything the rest of the week. And there's no way that that's right. God wants us to come to a place where we can go any place and do anything that will actually do the world some good. I mean, that's kind of the premise of the story that Jesus told about the Good Samaritan in Luke chapter 10. A guy gets mugged and left for dead. A couple of different religious guys pass right by him. They don't do anything. And then the most unexpected thing happens when a Samaritan who was despised for who he was and his ethnicity, he's the one who actually stops to help. And then Jesus throws this little observation into the story. As part of his help, it says he poured oil and wine on his wounds. Now, that may or may not mean anything to us, but devout Jews, truly devout Jews, who were focused on being in the right place and doing all the right things, would have instantly recognized that oil and wine were key ingredients of their temple worship. Jesus' point? What you use in here, in worship in the temple, what you use in this place, I want you to put to use out there in that place. If what you do in here isn't pushing you to do good out there, then what you're doing in here isn't doing anybody any good. God says His definition of being good is more than just being in the right place. But He also says that good isn't just making the right payments either. Micah's message was this: you'll never fix your focus if you think you can just bribe God to drop His charges against you. What's it going to take to make this go away, God? How much do you need from us for us to be okay again? People are willing to pay God's price because it makes us feel like we're back in control of things again. What do you want, God? More burnt offerings? More sacrifices? More oil? Do you want my kids, God? You see, He's willing to offer anything but who He is. He's willing to show up at the right place and bring the right payment, just like it was some kind of a drug deal going on in a parking lot behind a factory someplace. Just tell us what you want, God. I'll show up and I'll bring the payoff with me. Micah wasn't the only spokesman of God at that time. Isaiah was a contemporary of his. And Isaiah says of the conditions that he saw in Isaiah 1 verses 11 and following this way: "What makes you think I want all of your sacrifices, says the Lord? I'm sick of your burnt offerings of rams and the fat of fattened cattle. I get no pleasure from the blood of bulls and goats and lambs. When you come to worship me, who asks you to parade through my courts with all of your ceremonies? Stop bringing me your meaningless gifts. The incense of your offerings disgusts me. And as for your celebrations of the new moon and the Sabbath and your special days for fasting, they're all sinful and false. I want no more of your pious meetings. I hate your new moon celebrations and your annual festivals. They're a burden to me that I cannot stand." Wait a minute, God. All those things that you say you hate, those were your idea. You're the one, God, who told us to do that stuff in the beginning. Why are you mad at us now for doing what you told us to do? He tells him why in verse 15 of Isaiah 1. "When you lift up your hands in prayer, I won't look. Though you offer many prayers, I will not listen, for your hands are covered with the blood of innocent victims. Wash yourselves and be clean. Get your sins out of my sight. Give up your evil ways. Learn to do good. Seek justice. Help the oppressed. Defend the cause of the orphans. Fight for the rights of the widows." You see, God is incredulous that they would think that they could just go to the right place at the right time with the right stuff and then be free to treat people however they wanted to treat them. Why would He be okay with that? And yet that was their assumption. You see, God needed to help them, like He needs to help us, focus on what is good, like justice, mercy, and humility. And to do that, simply stated, to fix their focus, He says, it's good to treat people right. God considers it to be good when His people fix their focus on the needs of others. That's something that made the religion of God's people different than all the other religions of the world around them. They focused on the elite upper class royalty as an indication of God's favor in their life. But Israel's God was different. You see, he actually cared about people. He cared about his people when they would care for those who were less fortunate than them. Let me read four different verses for you that give you a flavor of the things that God thought were right about treating other people right. In Deuteronomy 10, verse 18, he tells them, make sure that orphans and widows receive justice. He loves the foreigners who live with our people and gives them food and clothes. Or in Psalm 146, verse 7 and 8, he gives justice to the poor and food to the hungry. The Lord sets the prisoners free and heals the blind eyes. He gives a helping hand to everyone who falls. The Lord loves good people. And in the book of wisdom of Proverbs 14, verse 31, if you mistreat the poor, you insult their creator. But helping the poor honors him. And finally, in Zechariah 7, verse 9 and 10, long ago I gave these commands to my people. You must see that justice is done and show kindness and mercy to one another. Do not oppress the widows and the orphans, the foreigners who live among you, or anyone else in need, and do not plan ways of harming one another. You see, God has always been clear about what he thinks is good. Justice, mercy, and the humility to actually show that to others. When Jesus was born, he wasn't born into the privileged class of the rich and famous. Most of his ministry was to people who actually lived their life in the margins. Things like justice and mercy and humility, those are all things that God made pretty clear what it would take to fix the focus of the people that were religious in his day. God wants his people to fix their focus on what's good, but remember, good must never replace the good news. From Micah all the way through the life of Jesus, those uber-religious Pharisees were obsessed with doing the right thing and being seen by others as doing the right thing. Oh, make no mistake. Even though they did good things, life is still out of focus if our goodness never shares the good news. Or if we think that the good things that we do take the place of the good news of the gospel. Paul would write to Titus and say this in Titus 3, verse 4 and 5. When the kindness and the love of God our Savior was shown, he saved us because of his mercy. It was not because of good deeds that we did to be right with him. He saved us through the washing that made us new people through his Holy Spirit. It can't be any more clear than that, can it? We're not saved because we did good stuff. We do good things because we are saved by God. Depending on our good deeds to be right with God makes us the same as the people in Micah's day that were trying to plea bargain. What else do you want us to do, God? What's it going to take to make this go away? When can we have normal back? Our salvation depends on the mercy of God, our Savior, who makes us new people by washing away our sins and filling us with His Spirit. We are saved because of what God does within us, not because of the good that we do for others. And it's because justice, mercy, and humility has given us new clarity and fixed our focus that we remember that we share good news with others. Let me give you a quick illustration while I wrap up. How do you share the good news that will fix not only your focus, but the focus of those around you? You might try asking this question first. Where do you stand with God? Most people will say something like, oh, I don't know, I guess we're okay. I'm good. Me and God are good. But then follow that with a simple question. Tell me why you believe that. Why do you believe that you and God are good? And again, most people will probably say, well, I try to be a good person. I I'm not perfect, but I try to be good and think I do more good than harm in the world. And that's when you would ask, have you been perfect your whole life? Have you always been good? Have you always done the right thing? And most will be honest to quickly say, oh, well, I'm not perfect. I've made my mistakes. And that's when you ask, do you realize that good people don't go to heaven? Forgiven people are the ones who go to heaven. Do you know what God said about how to be forgiven? In Acts 2 and verse 38, he tells people there who were crushed when they realized the mistakes that they'd made and the impact that that would have on their relationship with God. He says, repent. A number of translations will translate that or paraphrase that. Change your heart and your life. And be baptized for the forgiveness of your sins. Then you will receive His Spirit. Forgiven people. That's who stands right with God. God needs us to fix our focus and allow Him to tell us what's good. This coming new year, we desperately need a new focus. It's pretty much hit us in the mouth, like Mike Tyson said. And as we shake the cobwebs clear and focus again on how to live in this new year, may we do so allowing God to define justice, mercy,